Hi, welcome. I'm waiting just now for Father Stan Drungowski, our chaplain, and he's on his way. And so while he's on his way, I'll introduce myself. I'm Dr. John Pinero. I'm Director of Catholic Studies at Aquinas College. And I help with the help of some other good folks run this Catholic Studies speaker series. And the speaker series has brought a lot of good people and interesting people to Aquinas over the past several years. Maybe you came to hear Father Robert Barron last summer, or some of the other folks we've had here. And just wanted to remind you that the speaker series is run entirely due to our gracious benefactors. And if ever you would like to help us support, keep bringing great people like Father Paul Murray, whom I heard a couple of years, maybe it was a year ago, a year and a half ago at the University of Mary, and it was excellent. He was excellent, and I thought, like, we got to bring him here, and to keep bringing good people for you all, it'd be a really big help. So if you'd like to do that, I'd also like to point out in the back, you see on a couple easels there, we have plans for the new Aquinas Chapel. This would be our first building on campus built for the specific purpose of being a chapel, and I think it's going to be a noble and beautiful chapel. And you can take a look at that, and there's some brochures and other items in the back about that, as well as about Catholic Studies and Aquinas College. I'd like to now invite our campus chaplain, Father Stan Drungowski, up. He will deliver our invocation this evening, and then we'll thank you.
In the name of the Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Spirit. God of greatness, God of love, from soundless darkness you brought forth the music of creation. In this creation, you created humanity. In humanity, the image and likeness of yourself, you have given us the greatest possibility of all, and that is the gift of awe. To be able to stand in awe of the power of your love, and as we have needed it, the power of your mercy. Allow us to always remember that you are supreme, that you are the great source of all, and that from you we have all that we are. Grant us the gift of truth, to know who we are, to know from where we come, and to have a vision of our destiny, to be one with you. Be with our speaker this evening. Allow the power of your truth to flow from his lips, and the truth of your love to come to us from his heart. We offer this prayer in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord.
Some of you might already be familiar with our speaker. He's the author of several books, including one on now Saint Teresa of Calcutta, and several other good works that I would recommend to you. And I think it's, well, I'd have to say, after spending some time in Ireland, it's hard to find an Irishman who isn't a poet. I think we have a very good one here tonight, and that's very nice too. Paul Murray is an Irish Dominican and poet and professor in Rome at the University of St. Thomas, known to many as the Angelicum. He's the author, as I said, of several books that have been published here in Ireland, in England. And tonight he's here to talk to us about Thomas Aquinas, our school's namesake, and the title is Thomas Aquinas, Poet and Contemplative. Please welcome Father Paul Murray.
Thank you, John, Dr. Pinero. I count it not only a privilege, but a real joy to be part of the Catholic Studies Speakers Series, and in particular to be given the opportunity this evening here at Aquinas College to speak about Aquinas, poet and contemplative. Aquinas spent most of his working life as a scholar, an academic in a university setting, a university campus. Academics, we know, tend to be talkative people, and even sometimes hard-nosed people and polemical. I'm sure Aquinas College is an exception. To their peers, academics almost never appear particularly holy or mystical. Was Aquinas an exception? Can we think of him, therefore, not only as a scholar on campus, but as a mystic on campus? That Aquinas was a profoundly wise man goes without saying, but what evidence is there to suggest that his interior life was marked by that depth of spiritual experience, that contemplative intimacy we associate with the great Christian mystics? I want to begin our reflections by drawing attention to an extraordinary text, a truly unique and bizarre document, in my opinion. Its author is the celebrated friend and confidant of Hans Urs von Balthasar, Adrian von Speyer. The text contains a number of negative judgments regarding the contemplative life of Thomas Aquinas. Judgments based not on any kind of ordinary intellectual reflection on the prayer life of the saint, but rather on knowledge which von Speyer claims she received directly from a seeing, a vision of Aquinas at prayer. Although not on principle suspicious of such alleged visions, I'm by no means persuaded that in this particular case von Speyer gained access to the hidden truth concerning the prayer life of Aquinas, but you can judge for yourselves. From start to finish, von Speyer casts a distinctly cold eye on the question of Thomas's prayer life and contemplative experience. God, she declares, is a concept for him, something to analyze, to take apart and put back together. Love is not there, she declares. Everything remains intellectual. And she continues, he is the one who leads God, as it were, rather than allowing himself to be led by God. He lacks a certain magnanimity. Unquote. Apart from manifest gifts of wisdom and insight, in the end, all that Thomas's contemplative life adds up to, we're told, is something narrow and ungenerous, a faith experience of life in the Spirit, which hardly bears comparison with that of the great contemplatives of the Church. In von Speyer's words, a meager, subjective experience of grace. At best, he gets a pass mark. When we compare the writings of Aquinas with those of the mystics, von Speyer might seem to have a point. Thomas is a scholastic theologian. He is an intellectual through and through. His style is measured, austere, and impersonal. In contrast, the writings of the mystics possess a vocabulary and a style which, generally speaking, can be described as distinctly vivid and spontaneous, dynamic and effective. Their work is visionary in tendency and is almost always of an immediate psychological interest. In contrast, that of Aquinas is decidedly reserved, plain-spoken, and ontological. No wonder then that both at a popular level and in the world of academe, although regarded as a great Christian philosopher and as an outstanding speculative theologian, Aquinas has not generally been thought of as a spiritual author and has never been regarded as a Christian mystic with the distinctive character and genius of someone like St. John of the Cross. That Aquinas was an outstanding scholastic theologian, a man with a genius for abstract speculation, is clear. But what over the centuries has generally been ignored in the academic world and is still today little known by many of our contemporaries is that Aquinas was first and last a teacher of scripture, a master of the sacred page. And no less forgotten, no less strangely overlooked, are two other aspects of Aquinas's life and work: his quite remarkable genius as a poet and the decidedly mystical or contemplative character of his theology. The average reader of Aquinas can all too easily be put off by an initial encounter with the more insistently speculative and abstract character of his work. This point we find underscored in a characteristically humorous way by G.K. Chesterton. Chesterton writes, "A lady I know picked up a book of selections from Thomas Aquinas with a commentary and began hopefully to read a section with the innocent heading, The Simplicity of God. She laid down the book with a sigh and said, well, if that's his simplicity, I wonder what his complexity is like. Readers tend to be struck by what appears as a closed, impersonal character of Aquinas' work. One scholar writes, we are in the dark when we attempt to discover the man behind the scholar. But is this true? When reading the text of Aquinas, are we always confronted by a great academic merely, and not by a man of prayer, not by a spiritual master? Is there, in reality, no direct way of gaining access to Aquinas the contemplative? On one occasion, reflecting back on what it was like to enjoy close and fraternal contact with St. Thomas, a Dominican contemporary remarked, it was a refreshment to the spirit merely to live with him and to be able from time to time to speak with him. Of course, that kind of direct, intimate conversation is no longer possible. Nevertheless, with regard to prayer, we do have surprising access to what might be called the actual speaking voice of the saint. Aquinas not merely talking about prayer in the abstract, but actually praying. The man, the theologian, overheard, as it were, in the very act of prayer and meditation. Here, for example, are lines from one of the prayers composed by Aquinas. Although we almost never hear the word I used by Aquinas in his theology, that's certainly not the case, obviously, when it comes to private prayer. He writes, in translation, I praise, glorify, and bless you, my God, for the immeasurable favors shown to me, who am unworthy. I praise your kind forbearance, waiting on me for so long, and your gentleness appearing in the guise of a sharp reprisal. I praise your tenderness, calling out to me, your kindness, supporting me, your mercy, forgiving my sins. I praise your goodness, forgiving me more than I deserve, and your patience for not remembering past injuries. This is one of the prayers from the P.A. Preces. Maybe at the end, question time, I'll have an opportunity to talk about the authenticity of the P.A. Preces, or at most of them. Another prayer, the prayer for wise ordering, makes manifest from first word to last a quiet yet urgent determination of both mind and heart to surrender everything to God. The prayer is said by a man, a Dominican, asking for living knowledge of God. But though it is a prayer clearly composed by an intellectual, the wisdom being sought is no mere intellectual knowledge. Rather, it is that wisdom of spirit which impacts on every aspect of life, both interior and exterior. Here's a brief extract. Put order into my life and grant that I may know what it is you require me to do and help me to achieve whatever is fitting and necessary for the good of my soul. Christian prayer can very often take the form of asking God for help, at times even pleading for divine assistance. As a result, it can all too easily be caricatured as a demeaning, slavish form of behavior, an activity that in some way undermines the dignity of the human person. But Thomas, although by no means unwilling to reveal the depth of his need for grace, stands before us and stands before God in this prayer with an unmistakable strength of presence and strength of character. Something of that character, I would suggest, is revealed in the strong, radiant adjectives he chooses when describing in the prayer the kind of person he would most wish to become with God's help, namely, vigilant, noble, unconquered, free, and upright. Give me, dearest God, a vigilant heart, which no distracting thought can lure away from you, Give me a noble heart, which no unworthy desire can ever debase. Give me an unconquered heart, which no tribulation can fatigue. Give me a free heart, which no violent temptation can enslave. Give me an upright heart, which no perverse intention can hold fast. Reading over these five short petitions, one is made aware not only of a devoted man of prayer, but also of someone well schooled in the knowledge of the human heart, acquainted with its virtues and vices, its weaknesses and its wounds, its fears and longings, and its irrepressible capacity for greatness. What St. Thomas desires are, yes, the gifts of God, but what matters for him even more than life itself is the author of life. Towards the end of the prayer, we find a notable repetition of the words you and yours. The focus of both mind and heart is on God and God alone. And if it was not already obvious earlier in the prayer, it now becomes abundantly clear. The mind behind the prayer is a mind in continual search of knowledge of God, a mind in love with God. Grant me, Lord my God, intelligence in knowing you, diligence in seeking you, wisdom in finding you, conversation pleasing to you, perseverance in confidently waiting for you, and confidence in finally embracing you. I'm reminded here of that famous reply Thomas made to the voice he heard speaking to him from the crucifix in Naples. Thomas, you have written well of me. What reward will you take from me for your labors? And the reply of Thomas, nil nisi te, Domine, Lord, nothing but yourself. The most celebrated prayers composed by Aquinas are not works in prose, but remarkable poems. I'm referring, of course, to the hymns composed for the newly established feast of Corpus Christi in 1254. The Penguin Book of Latin Verse describes them as beautiful poems, dignified, majestic, and of perfect technique. And Jared Manley Hopkins, the great Jesuit poet, declared that the poems and canticles of St. Thomas are remarkable works of genius. Aquinas, we know, is the greatest, arguably, the greatest theologian of the Middle Ages, but he is also, arguably, the greatest Latin poet of the Middle Ages. Not the greatest poet, it's Dante, but the greatest Latin poet, perhaps, of the Middle Ages. I'd like to read to you this evening, albeit an English translation for the most part, a few of Aquinas' Eucharistic hymns or poems, and to offer some kind of extended commentary. The first of the hymns is Pange Lingua, a work Thomas composed for the first Vespers of Corpus Christi. Here are its first two verses in the original Latin. You know them well. But listen to the rhymes. Pange lingua gloriosi, corporis mysterium, sanguinisque preciosi, quem in mundi precium, fructus ventris generosi, rex effudit gentium. Nobis datus, nobis natus, ex intacta virgine, et in mundu conversatus, sparso verbi semine, sui moras incolatus, miro claudit ordine. Pange lingua, sing, O tongue. The first words chosen by Aquinas to open the hymn alert us at once to the nature of the work before us. Here Aquinas is not engaged in composing a philosophical or theological treatise. He's not attempting to write prose. Instead, we find him engaged in writing words for a sacred song. In effect, he's writing a poem. And as readers of Aquinas' work, instead of being, as it were, together in a classroom with a teacher, we find ourselves in a place of worship, in a liturgical context. For in this place, we are invited not merely to think about the mystery of the Eucharist, not merely to pray, but instead raising our voices in prayer to sing together, as it were, first vespers of the feast of Corpus Christi. Let me read you now the hymn in its entirety in English translation. It's mostly translations which I've stolen from work done over the last few centuries, but I have reworked it a little bit, added and subtracted, but it's mostly not my own. Sing, my tongue, the Savior's glory, of his flesh the mystery sing, of the blood all price exceeding, shed by our immortal King, destined for the world's redemption from a noble womb to spring. Given for us and condescending to be born for us below, high with lowly converse blending, far the seed of truth to sow, till he died with wondrous ending, bearing all our weight of woe. At that last great supper lying, circled by his chosen band, humbly with the law complying, first he finished its command, then immortal food supplying, gave himself with his own hand. Word made flesh, the bread of nature, by his word to flesh he turns, wine into his blood he changes, though our sense no change discerns. But if inmost heart be earnest, faith her lesson quickly learns. Therefore we before him bending this great sacrament revere, types and shadows have their ending, for the newer rite is here. Faith, our outward sense befriending, makes our inward vision clear. Glory let us give and blessing to the Father and the Son, honor, might, and praise addressing while eternal ages run, ever too his love confessing, who from both with both is one. That invitation to adore the Lord. I came upon a very interesting text about a visit of the Comte de Montalembert in the middle of the 19th century to Ireland. And he speaks about a visit to a very poor little chapel up in the mountains. And he wrote, because it's just a revelation of such a spirit of adoration, humble adoration. He writes, "I shall never forget the first Mass which I heard in a country chapel. I rode to the foot of a hill. I saw a cruciform building, badly built of stone without cement and covered by thatch. Around it knelt a crowd of robust and vigorous men, all uncovered, though the rain fell in torrents and the mud quivered beneath them. Profound silence reigned everywhere. It was the Catholic chapel of Blarney, and the priest was saying Mass. There were no seats, no decorations, not even a pavement. The floor was of earth, damp and stony, the roof dilapidated. I reached the door at the moment of the elevation, and all this pious assembly had prostrated themselves with their faces on the earth." As author, as poet of the Pangilingua, how well can we say Aquinas has succeeded in his task? The great scholar F.J.E. Rabi does not hesitate to declare that Pangilingua is, quote, "one of the most sublime productions of sacred poetry. It is," he remarks, "a hymn beyond all praise, a work distinguished not only by a fine precision of thought, but also by a severe and rigid beauty." The work is, I'm happy to agree, astonishing in the way it links together profound dogmatic reflection with a carefully wrought musical and rhythmic structure. One other feature of the hymn, and it's something entirely original in medieval hymnody, adding greatly to the strength and beauty of the work, is the alternating triple rhymes in every stanza. For example, in the first stanza, the rhymes gloriosi, preciosi, and generosi alternate with mysterium, precium, and gentium. The artistic delight Aquinas must have had in inventing the challenge of this new stanza form, and then his genius in answering the challenge with such manifest success, attests not only to an undeniable sophistication in the Dominican as a maker of verses, but also to an instinctive love of play where words are concerned, a marked awareness of the taste and shimmery of words, which in the end separates the genuine poet from the mere versifier. Poets, writes Dylan Thomas, poets have got to enjoy themselves sometimes, and the twistings and convolutions of words, the inventions and contrivances, are all part of the joy that is part of the painful voluntary work. The fourth stanza, highlighting aspects of the mystery of Christ's presence in the Eucharist, might very easily, under the weight of theological reflection, have begun to sound rather stiff and abstract. But happily, the music of the stanza more than matches the dogmatic element. The intellect of Aquinas is here as alive as ever. But also in evidence are two of the necessary gifts or qualities of the poet, craft and imagination. And so by the grace and alchemy of art, discourse combines with image and thought with phrase to achieve an impressive harmony of sense and sound, a dance of the intellect among words. Verbum caro panem verum, verbo carnem efficit. Fit sanguis Christi merum, et si sensus deficit, ad firmandum cor sincerum, sola fides sufficit. Literally translated, word by word, well, not literally, word by word, the bread of nature, by his word to flesh he turns, wine into his blood he changes, though our sense no change discerns. But if inmost heart be earnest, faith her lesson quickly learns. In the hymn for Matins, Sacris Solemnis, the stanza beginning with the words Panis Angelicus is, of course, familiar to you, a stanza universally regarded as one of Aquinas's finest achievements in verse. Not only is there a felicitous inevitability about the lines from the point of view of rhyme, assonance, and alliteration, the actual message which the stanza contains is itself truly impressive, namely, the statement that even the least among us is invited to the banquet of the new Pasch. In translation, now the bread of angels feeds the sons of men. Figures and types are fled, never to come again. Oh, what a wondrous thing! The poor, the humble, the lowly consume the master and king. The lines are justly famous. Here Thomas is not speaking in the dogged abstract idiom of a scholastic philosopher or theologian. The mood, on the contrary, is one of calm amazement, an ecstasy of quiet thought and feeling. And the words, though plain and simple, are words transformed, quickened into rhythm, into song, by a sense of manifest wonder. Not surprisingly, the stanza has become one of the most admired and celebrated, being set to music on more than one occasion, and countless times performed by artists and singers across the world. Panis Angelicus, fit panis hominum, dat panis celicus, figuris terminum. O res mirabilis, man ducat dominum, pauper servus et humilis. What impresses at once is the concentrated rhythm of the stanza and the graced insistence and persuasive authority of its rhymes. Yes, the work undoubtedly bears the weight of a striking revelation, a truly profound theological message. But no less impressive is the way, with quiet, purposeful intensity, the lines sing. Here we are, without question, in the presence of a master craftsman. Aquinas, in the making of this particular stanza, must have experienced, and in no small measure, something of that deep sense of satisfaction and delight known to every creative artist and craftsman. Once, when he was commenting on a passage directly concerned with the close connection poets have with their own work, Aquinas remarked, every artisan or artist loves his own work. And this is especially true in the case of poets who love their own poems superabundantly as parents love their children. And he continued, to all human beings, their own being is an object of preference and love, for everything to the extent that it exists is good. No hint of Jansenism there. Aquinas then goes on to add that in the act of composing, in the actual making of a work of art, something of the poet or craftsman enters into the work itself. And it is for that reason, he concludes, both artisans and poets love their own works because they love their own being. And this is in the nature of things, namely, that everything loves its own being. But how are we to understand the phenomenon of Aquinas the poet? How was he capable in mid-career of writing poems and canticles of undisputed quality? Did his contemporaries not regard him first and last as the author of rigorously technical scholastic texts? Is it conceivable that apart from his apprenticeship as a theologian and philosopher, Aquinas had also been initiated at some earlier stage in his life into the craft or art of literary composition? As it happens, we have information available to us with regard to this question. In an article entitled The Angelic Doctor at Monte Cassino, the Benedictine scholar Tommaso Lecisotti offers an illuminating picture of the kind of education young Tommaso d'Aquino would have received at the monastery after he had been sent there by his parents at the age of 5. Apart from learning to recite the Psalms by heart, Aquinas, we're told, would have been expected to give time also to the study of music and to the art of composition. It's almost certain, therefore, that Thomas's eventual mastery of the craft of verse making was a skill acquired, at least in some initial form, as a direct result of his literary schooling at Monte Cassino. Another scholar, the Dominican Angelus Valls, writes, the art of writing was still cultivated in the monastery at that time. The rules of language and style were taught together with grammar. Thus the way was open to the great treasuries of literature and to the whole output of the world of letters. Of all the Corpus Christi hymns composed by Thomas, Sacris Solemnius, the hymn for Matins, is probably the least celebrated, and that's surprising, for it seems to possess all the characteristics for which the other Eucharistic hymns are justly famous. There is evidence, for example, from start to finish, of the same superb craftsmanship and the same austere beauty of thought and theological expression, and the same deliberate joining together of thought and music, the happy consonance of sound and meter with the meaning of the words. What taken as a whole the hymn proclaims most memorably is that angelic bread has become the food of mere mortals, and that this holy bread is nothing less than the body of Christ Jesus, the Lord. Aquinas exclaiming, O res mirabilis, O wondrous thing. This feast is one that clearly commands profound and solemn recognition and celebration. But solemnity is by no means the only thing of importance for Thomas in this context. In order fully to celebrate the feast, there must, he insists, be joy as well as solemnity. That's why from the beginning of Sacris Solemnius, we're invited to bring to the solemn rites and rubrics of the feast, to the external form of the celebration, an inner exuberant joy. In translation, to these our solemn rites, let all our joys be joined. And from our inmost heart and mind, let songs of praise resound. Let ancient forms depart, and everything be new, new in word, new in deed, and new in heart. For Thomas, true religion is never a matter of mere external observance. What's required, therefore, if a celebration such as Corpus Christi is to be fully authentic, is some spontaneous movement of the inner self, a welling up from the inmost heart of gratitude and praise. And something else as well. Mere religious feeling by itself, no matter how intense or seemingly profound, will mean little or nothing if not accompanied by practical charity. It's no accident, therefore, that Aquinas also speaks here of actual deeds or good works. In fact, at the close of the hymn's first stanza, he lists all three of these fundamental dimensions of the Christian experience. Corda is mentioned first, the praise of the inner heart, then voces, the shared external act of worship, and then finally opera, the putting into practice of the Christian faith in the form of good deeds. Nova sint omnia, corda, voces et opera. Let all things be new, hearts, voices, and works. In Sacri Solemniis, the institution of the Eucharist is presented by Aquinas as a response to the most immediate needs of the disciples of Jesus, their need because of weakness to be strengthened, and their need because of sorrow to be comforted. In translation, to those who were weak, he offered the support of his body as living food, and to those who were sad, the chalice of his blood, and said, take the cup I hand you now and drink from it. These last words of Jesus seem to have impressed themselves in the mind of Aquinas. In the Summa, he writes, last words, especially those spoken by departing friends, are committed most deeply to memory. Since then especially, affection for friends is more enkindled, and the things which affect us most are impressed the deepest in the soul. Manifest here the human heart of Aquinas. Saint John Paul came to the Angelicum on occasion, and I was there, and he gave a talk on Aquinas entitled St. Thomas Aquinas, Doctor Humanitatis. We know that Aquinas is the angelic doctor, but to call him Doctor Humanitatis is not in any sense to bring the great man down, far from it. The next poem of Aquinas I want to consider is by far the most joyous of all Aquinas' canticles. Entitled Laudation Salvatorem, it was written to be sung just before the Gospel at Mass on the Feast of Corpus Christi. It's an exhortation to Sion, the community of the redeemed, to praise Christ, the great Savior, leader, and shepherd. Laudation has been described, and for good reason, as the most theologically sophisticated of all Aquinas' canticles. It's hard to imagine, in fact, a hymn or sequence that could be more doctrinally Christian and Thomist. The impact of the word, however, given its incantatory power and its bold, sonorous diction, goes far beyond that of a mere dogmatic tract in verse. From the first words to the final strophe, Laudation holds our attention with the authority of a song and makes an impact like that of great music. Here are the first few stanzas in the original Latin. Laudation Salvatorem, lauda ducem et pastorem, in hymnis et canticis. Quantum potes tantum aude, quia major omni laude, nec laudare sufficis. And here now are several stanzas of the canticle in English translation. Sion, to your Savior sing, to your shepherd and your king, sing with canticle and hymn. Dare with song to praise him well, though he does all praise excel, never cease from praising him. Wondrous theme of mortal singing, living bread and bread life-giving is our theme, our task today. So let no one be deceived, the living bread the 12 received is the same that we consume. Sound the anthem, clear and strong, the fullest note, the sweetest song, the very music of the breast. For now there dawns a day sublime that brings remembrance of the time when Jesus first his table blessed. Now the new law's new oblation by the new king's revelation ends the form of ancient rite. Now the new, the old replaces. Truth away the shadow chases. Light dispels the gloom of night. What he did at supper seated, Christ ordained to be repeated in his memory divine. Wherefore now, his guidance taking, bread and wine we hallow, making lasting food for our salvation. This the truth each Christian learns. Bread into his flesh he turns. Wine becomes his holy blood. Though we feel it not nor see it, ardent faith which now reveals it, all defects of sense makes good. Look upon the altar lies, hidden deep from human eyes, bread of angels from the skies, made the food of mortal man. Children's food to dogs denied, in wondrous prophecy described, in the manna from the sky, in the binding of the boy, in the sacrificial lamb. Christ, good shepherd, bread divine, show to us your mercy sign. Feed us still, still keep us thine, that we may see your glory shine in the kingdom of the good. Source of all we have or know, come and guide us here below. Make us at your table seated, by your saints as friends be greeted, co-heirs at the feast of love. Laudation Salvatorum has been declared by the great scholar Rabi to be, quote, the supreme dogmatic poem of the Middle Ages. In his opinion, it possesses an austerity and grandeur which no Latin poet of the Middle Ages ever equaled. But can a poem be that dogmatic and still remain a poem? None of the other hymns or canticles by Aquinas contain so much theological or dogmatic reflection. And yet it has to be said, the poetry in Laudation is by no means defeated. On the contrary, the music, the unique lyrical pattern and structure of the work, more than holds its own with the doctrine or dogma being expressed. Aquinas, as poet, has clearly understood that with regard to beauty, the creation of beauty, it's not sufficient that a work of art should be richly charged with truth. The truth must be brought to a focus and strike on the mind as a simple and luminous unity. And that is precisely what has been achieved in Laudation Salvatorum. I've left to the very last the one work which I regard as the greatest of all the Eucharistic hymns of Aquinas, the Adore Te Devote, of the Eucharistic poems of Aquinas. In the composition of this meditation, Aquinas never appeared more alive as a poet, theologian, and man of prayer. The work is so fresh, so unexpected, it may even have marked a decisive moment in his spiritual life. Its unusually personal character and the unique beauty of its form and content set it apart from every other work of Aquinas, and indeed from every work of Latin verse in the Middle Ages. But what was it that inspired him to compose a work of this kind? Why, among all his other works, is there no other prayer, no other canticle, which reveals such a deep personal faith and which contains such a depth of longing? The most obvious answer to this question is that Aquinas is not attempting here to compose a prayer for communal use, a hymn which will in time form part of the sacred liturgy, part of the Corpus Christi liturgy. We tend to think of it more or less as belonging to that sequence, but he never composed it for Corpus Christi, for the communal hymn of the church. He composed it as a private poem. It's very interesting. You know, we sing this work, and we've got used to that almost as if it was a hymn from the beginning, but in fact it was simply a poem, and it was only after a few centuries that music was put to it, whereas the other Corpus Christi hymns, there was music right from the beginning accompanying them. Thomas's attention is in a sense here more modest, to compose a short poem, a work of private devotion, which will help him to concentrate on the mystery of Christ's presence in the Eucharist during Mass. It's only in recent centuries that we've come to think of the work as a hymn like the other great hymns in the liturgy of Corpus Christi. Let me read for you now the translation of Adorite Devote by Gerard Manley Hopkins, a translation that has been justly acclaimed. It begins, as you know, Godhead here in hiding, whom I do adore. Godhead, Deitas, was not in fact the word Thomas used, although we're familiar with that also in the Latin. Veritas was in the very early manuscripts. But the translation in English is so beautiful with Godhead, we'll just leave it, I think. Hopkins had several versions, translations, and I've culled what I think are the best lines. Godhead here in hiding, whom I do adore, masked by these bare shadows, shape and nothing more. See, Lord, at your service, low lies here a heart, lost, all lost in wonder at the God thou art. Seeing, touching, tasting, are in you deceived. How, says trusty hearing, that shall be believed. What God's Son has told me, take for truth I do. Truth itself speaks truly, or there's nothing true. On the cross your Godhead made no sign to men. Here thy very manhood steals from human ken. Both are my confession, both are my belief, and I pray the prayer of the dying thief. I am not like Thomas, wounds I cannot see, but can plainly call thee Lord and God as he. Make this faith the deeper every day I live, stronger hope to hold by, greater love to give. O thou our reminder of Christ crucified, living bread, the life of us for whom he died. Lend this life to me then, feed and feast my mind. There be thou the sweetness man was meant to find. Make the tender tale true of the pelican. Bathe me, Jesu Lord, in what your bosom ran, blood that but one drop of has the worth to win all the world forgiveness of its world of sin. Jesu, whom I look at veiled here below, I beseech you send me what I thirst for so. Some day to gaze on thee face to face in light and be blessed forever with your glory's sight. The fact that it is the Eucharist and not some other sacrament or other mystery of the faith which is the subject of this unique work is no accident. The Eucharist, Thomas declares, is the greatest of all the sacraments, the sign of supreme charity, and the upholder of our hope. Writing on one occasion directly on the theme of the Eucharist in the Summa, he explains how the blood and water which flowed from the side of Christ are symbols of the sacraments. What was once achieved by the Passion of Christ for the salvation of the world is now being wonderfully poured out for us in the Eucharist. In another place, taking up the words in St. John's Gospel, immediately there came out blood and water. Thomas writes, since the sacred mysteries derive their origin from that source, when you approach the awe-inspiring chalice, approach it as if you were about to drink from Christ's own side. Reading a text like this may help us to understand why Thomas was drawn not only to contemplate with wonder and silent awe the mystery of the Eucharist, but was drawn also to compose a thing of words, a poem of homage to the mystery. Speaking on one occasion about what inspires the making of verse or music or painting, W.H. Auden remarked, "The impulse to create a work of art is felt when in certain persons the passive awe provoked by sacred beings or events is transformed into a desire to express that awe in a rite of worship or homage. And to be fit homage, this rite must be beautiful. In poetry, the rite is verbal. It pays homage by naming." In Adorite Devote, Thomas, both as devout believer and as poet, pays homage to the Eucharist by naming the mystery. His words, of course, don't expect to grasp for a moment the wondrous truth they're attempting to describe. Theirs is a language of prayer and of surrender, a language more of enchantment than science, a canticle of deep and pure desire, a loving worship. In order, therefore, fully to understand the opening words of the prayer, their directness, their contemplative immediacy, we need to think of them as words spoken by a man kneeling in the presence of the raised host immediately after the consecration. They are words of loving adoration. We know that Thomas attended two masses. He celebrated one mass, and then he attended the mass of his secretary, Brother Reginald. And there's strong evidence to indicate that this poem, this prayer, was written by Thomas to be read sotto voce after the host was elevated up to the Paternoster. A lifetime of reflection and meditation on the mystery of the Eucharist finds here its most moving, most memorable expression. It is an event, we can say, of both form and vision, a miracle of creative attention. Rilke, the German poet, was surely not mistaken when he remarked, "If a thing is to speak to you, you must, for a certain time, regard it as the only thing that exists, the unique phenomenon that your diligent and exclusive love has placed at the center of the universe." At times reading Adorite Devote, it's impossible not to be struck by the direct personal voice of need and desire that makes itself heard again and again. I'm thinking in particular of the following petition, which in a quite remarkable way combines the utter desperation of need with the most absolute trust and confidence in God. I know of no more humble statement ever composed by Thomas Aquinas. First in English, "O true pelican, Lord Jesus, cleanse me, who am unclean, in your blood, one drop of which would be enough to save the whole world of all its defilement. Pie pelicane, Jesu Domine, me immundum, munda tuo sanguine, cuius una stila salvum facere, totum mundum posset omni scelere." The God to whom Adorite Devote is addressed remains unseen under the forms of bread and wine, Christ utterly present, utterly hidden. Here within the sacramental order, faith, not vision, is the believer's most immediate, most profound contact with God, a point emphasized strongly in the opening stanzas of the prayer. When, however, the prayer begins to draw to a close, Thomas, daring to lift his gaze above and beyond the limits of this world, expresses an unforgettably deep and heartfelt longing to see God face to face. "Jesu, whom I look at shrouded here below, I beseech thee, send me what I thirst for so, someday to gaze on thee face to face in light, and be blessed forever with thy glorious sight." One of the reasons why it has seemed fitting to draw this talk towards an end with a reflection on Adorite Devote is because the prayer contains, in an exemplary form, many of the most impressive characteristics of Aquinas as poet and contemplative. Adorite is the work not only of a theologian, that goes without saying, but its author is not only a profound thinker, he is also a very considerable artist and a man of the deepest humility. The sacred host before which he bows down with living faith and to which he gives full and loving attention contains in sacramental form the real presence of Christ Jesus. And every thought expressed in the prayer, every word spoken, suggests a surrender of both heart and mind. The author of Adorite Devote is a man of faith and prayer, a theologian on his knees. Thomas knew God not merely by theological formulae, but by what he calls the experience of divine goodness. He writes, "God is not far from us nor outside us, but rather he is in us, as Jeremiah says, 'You are in us, O Lord.' Thus the experience of the divine goodness is called tasting." In the end, of course, Thomas Aquinas remains silent about the inner workings of his own contemplative experience. He is, in that sense, we can say, a discreet mystic. Thomas Joseph Pieper reminds us, Thomas wishes to make plain not his own inner state, but his insight into a given subject. The end result is a mysticism never expressed in fascinating psychological or psycho-spiritual experience, but is rather made wonderfully manifest in inspired works of wisdom. In it, Orate Devote, two particular individuals are mentioned. Thomas identifies humbly with their prayer. Thomas the doubter and the dying thief. That speaks volumes about Aquinas' understanding of Christian prayer. For Thomas, every prayer, in a sense, is a prayer of asking, trusting in the misericordia, the loving mercy of God. Aquinas was a Christian mystic, not in spite of being a theologian, but because he was a theologian of a particular kind, a bonus theologus, a man wholly dedicated to the contemplation of truth and to the proclamation of the gospel. His wings of contemplation, to use one of his own images, were those of a dove of contemplation, not those of a raven. His life of contemplation, never for himself alone. He was a dove of kindness. Unlike the selfish raven, he never forgot the needs of others, but was always concerned to bring to them the fruits of his contemplation. Once, when paraphrasing a sentence of St. Paul, Thomas betrayed, if I'm not mistaken, something of his own deep contemplative spirit, and something also of his own burning apostolic desire for the good of others. Thomas writes, I long for you to be in the very heart, literally in the entrails of Christ Jesus. That is, in order that you may love him intimately and that you may be loved by him, for human life consists in this. It's my great privilege now, my great joy, to bring the talk to an end finally by reading three stanzas from Adorate Devote, both in the original Latin and in the remarkable English translation by Gerard Manley Hopkins. Hearing these words, we are in effect overhearing a saint at prayer, a man who happens to be the greatest poet of the Eucharist. It's my own conviction that when really listened to, the words of this prayer, their meaning, their music, make an impact like no other words of Aquinas. Adoro te, devote, latens veritas, quaes ubis figuris vere latitas, tibi se cor meum totum subicit, qui a te contemplans totum deficit. Godhead here in hiding, whom I do adore, masked by these bare shadows, shape and nothing more. See, Lord, at your service, lo, lies here a heart, lost, all lost in wonder at the God thou art. Plagas sicut Thomas non intu eor, Deum tamen meum te confitior. Fac me tibi semper magis credere, in te spem habere, te diligere. I am not like Thomas, wounds I cannot see, but can plainly call thee Lord and God as he. Make this faith the deeper every day I live, stronger hope to hold by, greater love to give. Jesu, quem velatum nunc aspicio, oro fiat illud quod tam sitio, ut te revelata cernens facie, visu sim beatus tuae gloriae. Jesu, whom I look at shrouded here below, I beseech you, send me what I thirst for so. Some day to gaze on you face to face in light and be blessed forever with your glory's sight. Thank you. Lord have mercy.
Thank you, Father. That was beautiful. I think in our day, we do see this divide between truth and beauty. And our last popes have spoke of it, Benedict and Pope John Paul II. I guess going forward, how do we as a laity and then as a simple parish priest, how do we begin to unify the truth, the dogmas, the truth, the teachings of the church, with also the beauty of life and of art? And
yes, thank you. Wonderful. I mean, first of all, beauty is what gets us moving in life, you know. Beauty of people, beauty of truth, it captivates us, you know. And without that, we don't really get moving. You can't do it by grim determination. Newman talks about that, you know, how we're drawn by hunch and intuition and feeling and so on. And it's absolutely true. And truth without beauty has no attraction, you know. And part of the reason why many of our contemporaries have turned away from Christ is that the beauty of truth has been obscured by a false dogmatism. And we need dogma, but there's been a false dogmatism. And the beauty of goodness of God has been obscured, I think, by a false moralism. We need the moral life. We need that leadership, and we need to know where to go and how to behave. But there has been sort of sometimes a grim moralism which took us back to the old law, which is not attractive at all. And I think we need a robust piety, but sometimes there was a false, saccharine, ghastly piety which would turn everybody off, you know? And so it's tremendously important that we manage in the new evangelization, you know, to recover the beauty of truth. And I think one of the ways is, and Pope Benedict has alerted to this, I mean, the marvel of our Catholic tradition. I mean, there's no tradition more beautiful on earth, really. And so yet we've sometimes cluttered our churches with ghastly pictures and so on. And I think to recover the beauty of music and the beauty of the liturgy, it's so, so key. And many of our younger contemporaries, you know, have a great longing to experience God through the beauty. And it's not just aesthetics they want. I think it is really that combination of which you speak, you know. Absolutely. And it's very interesting, Jesus himself, you know, that he drew people to him who were sinners, you know. And if he had simply delivered the 100 right ideas, you know, nobody would have come near the table. But he drew people, you see. And then gradually, you know, that the first thing God does, wants to do for us, to all, no matter what our condition, however fallen, is to bless us with his presence, his merciful presence, you know. And if we stay with him, he gets around to saying a lot of challenging things, you know what I mean. Earlier today, I was privileged to have a class with some of the students, and I quoted a great statement from St. John Paul about who are we as human beings. He said, "We are not the sum total of our faults and failings," he said. "We are the sum total of the Father's love for us and our capacity to become the image of his Son." It's such an encouraging statement, but there's such a challenge in it at the end. Our capacity to become the image of his Son. In other words, I mean, sometimes I think what I'm afraid of is my fear of darkness. And what I'm afraid of is the light and the possibility of greatness. And the saints were people who I think were captivated by the beauty of Christ, you know what I mean? And it's sometimes very hard for us and our contemporaries, you know, the thing is so overlaid by so many centuries of dust in a way. And the one thing is holiness, you know, that we might still have the ghastly statues, you know, that our preaching may be still tragic, but if you're a holy priest or a holy mother or father, you know, it shakes the dust like nothing else, you know. It's that witness which is unmistakable, the love. I remember seeing Mother Teresa coming into to airports, and most people weren't Catholic at all, but they recognized her, and everybody started crying, you know. And it wasn't sadness, it was that, you know, when you hear great music, unimaginably beautiful music, you find yourself in tears because you're longing for the beauty behind the beauty, you know what I mean. And so I think, I wish I could say I was a better man and I could say this, you know, but it is that saints I've met in my life have pierced me with the beauty of God, you know what I mean? It's unmistakable. And the first American I ever met gave me my Dominican vocation. He was a humble lay brother and Trappist. Out of the blue, you know, he gave me, he said, you're going to be a Dominican. And that stayed in my head, you know. But what struck me being with him, because he was a holy person, just I began to experience almost like something moving, as if I was a better person than I thought. You know, I had more possibilities. And so I think beauty, holiness is first and last, but I think the beauty of liturgy, of language, of our homilies somehow. And we have great examples of Bishop Robert Barron, you know, and he understands this whole theme, and he's spoken of it too, the place of beauty. I was privileged to spend a week with him earlier in the summer. It was brilliant. But maybe you'd like to share something more about it, maybe some other people want to ask a question, but I think it's such a fundamental thing. And here, you know, there's the beauty of Aquinas. So seldom do we hear about this, you know what I mean? And I'm in the Dominican Order, and even when I talk to people about Aquinas the poet, they say, no, he wasn't a poet, you know? And he was the greatest poet of his age in Latin. And so, you know, we really have to work to recover the beauty, the splendor of the tradition.
You referenced Gerard Manley Hopkins with regards to his translation of Adorate Devote. Did he do a lot of translations of Aquinas' work?
No. To my knowledge, that's the only one that I'm aware of.
Okay.
But there's quite a lot of very interesting variations, you know. He never clearly was satisfied with the end result, but...
Yeah, didn't he do like something like four translations?
Yes, about four or five translations, okay. Yeah. So. Yeah, I don't know of any other, but... what a wonder he is. And again, I know someone who is a great Dominican, who was converted by reading Hopkins. Yeah. And I think Paul Claudel was converted by reading Arthur Rimbaud, even though Rimbaud wasn't a Christian, you know, but somehow the shaking, the desire, the ache that was in the poetry gave him a sense of something other. Yes.
Thank you very much. You focused on the poetry and hymns of Thomas. You've also done work on the prayers.
Yes.
And you began with that. And you mentioned the fact that you actually believe the prayers attributed to Thomas probably were from Thomas. Can you say, you mentioned that.
Yes, sure.
Bring
thank
it
you.
Up at the
yes. Well, thank you,
question
because,
and answer.
You see, the P.A. Preces, which in Thomas's opera Omnia are included in a volume which are possibly, you know, possibly Thomas, you know, that was the tradition. However, most people over the centuries, right up to Congar, Sertilange, all these people, just took for granted these were really Thomas, most likely, you know. And there was a German scholar, Lydia Meidel, who's written a lot about Aquinas and this. And she published a book in which she said, no, probably these are not Aquinas. It's probably some anonymous Dominican, you know? And that was rather sad to read. You know, it was going to be lost, no longer linked with the Aquinas' name. But I'm delighted to say that 2 years after she published her book, there was a great thesis published in Canada by a scholar called Le Brun. And Le Brun uncovered two key manuscripts of the work by William of Tocco, who was a contemporary of Aquinas and wrote the first history of Aquinas. And that had been what was considered to be the definitive edition of Tocco's work by Prumer. I think it was around the 20th century, around maybe just 12 years into the 20th century. Yeah. And but he had overlooked these two key manuscripts. And so she rediscovered them, and what she discovered is that two of the P.A. Preces were included by Tocco, Aquinas' contemporary, and attributed to Aquinas. And the two prayers are Adorate Devote, which of course wasn't a hymn, it was a prayer in its entirety there, with veritas instead of deitas, and the other one was the prayer for wise ordering, which I read mostly. So those two prayers were included by her. And I did some research, it's in that book I did on Aquinas and prayer, because in fact, Thomas in those that second prayer particularly was actually quoting from a letter written by the master of the order at that time, Humbert of Romans, another saint of the order. And there are, from that same section in Humbert's letter, about four of the other P.A. Preces do the same kind of work. They take the prose and translate it into a more poetic kind of prose and prayer. So almost certainly they are Aquinas also. So it's very persuasive, and I was very excited and there's other evidence besides, but that's the burden of it. So it's really wonderful that we can think of these as almost certainly Aquinas at prayer, yeah. You know, one of the things I think, if I can say, about it's the human side that comes through, you know, in the poet, and that Aquinas is such a great Christian humanist, you know. And he defends the arts and drama and theater like no other doctor of the church, because some of them were pretty severe, you know, and also good humor, all of that side, you know. Aquinas says in the Summa, if a person is incapable of saying something funny, that person is morally unsound. About that, you know. I had to discover some of these things for myself, I'm afraid. Yeah. So, then.
Thank you so much, Father. I first off, I just have to thank you for your own poetry. It's right. Really helped shape me in my own life.
Thank you.
I really appreciate it. But as a Dominican and a poet, I'm curious, when did you become aware of St. Thomas Aquinas' own poetic gift?
Yes.
And when did you fall in love with his poetry, and how has it shaped your own view of poetry?
Yes. You know, I suppose, like us all, you know, we're going to the benediction, you know, and we're singing the hymns, and there is, and it's, you know, and it somehow, even though I hadn't a clue what I was saying, we're all held by the beauty, you see. And somehow, most people haven't had a clue what's happening. But of course, at another level, we do know. And it's amazing how words can carry. And Eliot explains that. You can read Dante before understanding a word of it, and its magic can hit you, you know. So in that sense, I was captivated as a little boy. I think by the age of six, I would say, with that kind of experience, benediction, going to mass, you know, it was all in Latin, of course. But I think I more or less, whatever I have of knowledge of God, understanding, I think I got it by the age of six, and the rest has been footnotes in a way, you know. But, and I think really, I think we underestimate children, honestly. But I would say it was quite late. I mean, when I was doing theology, I was almost attracted more to the, in a sense, the more rooted, the more practical side. No, I mean, real speculative theology is not abstract in a negative sense. It's truly practical. It's truly thinking. It's truly necessary, you know. But in my limitations, I'd never any great capacity for sustained speculative thinking. So I was always attracted in the saints and theologians to like letters, autobiographies, poems, and things like that. And so that was my interest, and that's why I find myself teaching spirituality and teaching the great saints and mystics, I suppose, of the church. But it was in the last years that I discovered so few people knew about this, you know, and I was beginning to be so interested. And although I don't see myself as a big scholar of Thomas at all, but I threw myself into it as best I could. And it was a great joy to do. And I hope that, because people still really, they don't always want to know this Thomas. That's the other thing I've discovered. People have got used to an impersonal kind of Thomas and so on, the metaphysics, and they find this a bit much, you know, this piety thing, you see. But one of the, like von Balthasar said, a very astonishing thing. He was given a prize by John Paul for theology on one occasion, and he gave a little speech of a few paragraphs. And he said, the greatest single disaster in the history of the Catholic Church, you know, there's lots of candidates for that, you know. But what will be the greatest single disaster? He said the greatest single disaster in the history of the Catholic Church is the separation between theology and spirituality, between prayer and thinking, you know. Because they've gone off in two directions, you know. And theology became very dry, very abstract, rather proud, you know, the theologian and his books with his room and so on, remote from the living faith of the people, you know. Piety went off without a single sensible thought in its head and became ultra-pious, dripping and silly, you know what I mean? And both needed each other and so on. And so what you find in the great Aquinas, you know, is the intimate connection, the living bond between these two, you know, which is beautiful, because that kind of theology is truly ugly. I mean, theology in many ways has died on us, you know, because those exchange of essays, you know, and footnotes and so on. I mean, I believe in scholarship, but I do think we're at a crisis. And part of the crisis is beauty, you know what I mean? And I think we've tremendous help from people like Benedict, you know, in the way he writes. But my God, the theologians are still, it's like, and then there's still the crazy. But we need to be pious, we need to be grounded in humble piety, and we need to have solid heads, really thinking, really questioning the text, and letting ourselves be tested by the text. You know, and I think we're living in a good age. I think a lot is happening and bringing it together. I mean, I can think now many of the priests that I know, I live with a lot of people from the developing world in Rome, and they are people who have really been educated, like in reading the Fathers, as well as the great speculative theologians, reading scripture. You know, they're much closer and in that link, you know, than we were and growing up. And because for me, a lot of the we had very good men teaching us, but it felt, I mean, my little limitation, I wasn't very awakened. And some of it I had to discover for myself. And it was through a love of poetry and Shakespeare and other things. Then I would look back and I said, my goodness, Aquinas, you know, he's not Shakespeare, but goodness, he's an interesting poet, you know. And but thank you for that question. Yes.
I would assume your counsel about deepening prayer life would be specific to the individual you're speaking to, but do you have general counsel about how to deepen yes. the sense of the presence of God and the conforming of your life
Yes.
to the reality and the truth and the beauty of God?
There is the question. You know, I mean, of course, you're absolutely right. It, you know, a person should just pray as they can, not as they'd like to, or not as they think they should, you know. And it's very interesting when, you know, prayer begins to look at such a complicated thing, and we don't find it easy, it seems, you know. But yet, when the disciples who didn't know how to pray asked Jesus, he just gave them a vocal prayer, you know what I mean? And there's something very important about that. The Dominican tradition, I mean, really, and Thomas in particular, have always resisted any kind of esotericism about prayer, you know. And they always bring it down to the gospel kind of simplicity. That one of the statements made from the beginning of the Dominican Order, and you find it also in Vincent McNabb in the 20th century, prayer is such an easy job, you know. No Carmelite will ever let you know that. I love the Carmelites, you know. But there's something, we shouldn't frighten ourselves about prayer. And Thomas Aquinas, who was obsessed with prayer, he wrote about prayer all his life. And at the end, in the Summa, finally, he reached the point where he said, however profound it gets, all prayer is asking. You know, it's grounded in such a rat. We receive so much from God, and we need so much, you know. We're not to be ashamed of that condition. Of course, that doesn't mean there isn't the prayer of quiet on these things, but at core, our reality as creatures is that, you know. So the simplicity of really asking. And I think, yes, it would be great if I could find the right form of meditation or do something, right? But in my life, your question, often it's not that I find a way to pray, but prayer finds me through, I get into trouble, you know what I mean? I mess up, I do the wrong thing, and I feel so bad. And I've hurt other people, and I have to go down to the root of my desire. I have to go live at a deeper level just to get through this, you know? So I think often suffering is the context for deeper prayer, you know? And also love. I mean, when you find yourself loved by someone, when you don't feel you deserved it, or even in the order, I feel that so often, you know? And I think that can quicken, or the beauty of someone, the beauty of nature, you know, can pierce you so that you, the thing is, we have this desire so deep in us, but we remain very far away from it. And there's prayer, and like this is the Holy Spirit, is there within us, since baptism especially, praying away. And how do I get down to there, you know what I mean? And I find myself unless I'm suffering, I can pop up to my superficial self at any moment, you know. So when I am in hard times, you know, I always say to the Lord, Lord, use this time now to unite me with yourself and with others and that. But I think that's it. Ways to get to connect with that ache. But it's really there. And the other thing is, and Aquinas says this, the heart of prayer is God praying to God. It's as profound as that. Like, a prayer looks like, but prayer is much more profound than great intellectual thinking, for example. It's the breath of God. And you and I don't know how to do it. In fact, we can't do it. And prayer often really gets moving when I realize I'm not good at this at all, you know what I mean? And you have to fall back on God, you know. And whether you find a method or find something, but the thing to do is to have the, not to be ashamed of the poverty of spirit that comes with that, you know what I mean? And Mother Teresa said to me, you know, if at your time of prayer, it seems to you, not only have you been distracted, Father Paul, but you have done absolutely nothing. She must have known me very well. And she said, never leave that time of prayer bitter and angry with yourself. Before you leave, the she says, first turn to God and give God that nothing. I think that's so important, because in that 1 second, you are allowing God to be God, and you are being yourself before God, you know what I mean? And that's as good as an hour's meditation, you know what I mean? If you can really be yourself before God and let God be God, you know what I mean? And so wise a teaching. But again, if I was for a mind of prayer, I'm sure I'd say something more sensible, but I think also witnesses, you know, it's so important, the saints, the witness, that we read about them, that we get encouragement. And the thing was, they weren't good at it either. You know, when you read St. Teresa of Avila, she spent 18 years avoiding prayer. She said, the most difficult thing in my life was to go into the meditation hall, you know. And one of the reasons, she said, I hated it. And one of the reasons was because of her sins. Her spiritual director didn't allow her to tell us what the sins were, but we can have some idea. But she was mortified by the sins, and she felt so embarrassed before God. And she said at one stage she decided to give up prayer altogether, and she was going to get her moral life together. And then when she pulled herself together, she would go and and so it was a Dominican, Vincente Baron, who told her, pull yourself together, you know, you're never going to get any change without prayer. So be as embarrassed as you like, but keep praying. That's the thing, you know what I mean? And so no matter the thing, and the thing, prayer is more what God is doing to me than my little method, you know. Let it be done unto me. Most of the Mass is what's happening done to us. Pope Benedict has the most wonderful paragraph in his book, Introduction to Christianity, in which he says, you know, he uses the phrase, the primacy of acceptance. That's grace, you know. So much has happened for us before I started praying at all. So the whole ground has been mostly, the profundities are taken care of. I somehow have to fall into them, you know. And he said, yes, your good deeds, your methods of prayer, all that's important, but that's not the primary thing. The first thing is really to accept that so much has happened, that you have been loved to this degree. And you mightn't feel it, but accept it. And he said, if you can do that, if you can't do that, you will live a gloomy, guilt-ridden existence. You know what I mean? If you can do that, you live a cheerful, happy time. Not presumptuous in the wrong way, you know, because, you know, you fail and you have to go in confession and so on, fine. But you live with that freedom that Therese talks about, a kind of a happy presumption as the daughter or the son of God, you know? And I think Therese is a terrific witness. But the saints, I think, and even people in our lives, to remember them, you know, that they were capable of it. And asking the help of people of prayer is a terrific thing, to ask them to pray for you. I mean, you know, if anything good came out of this evening, you know, because I really do ask for any time I'm giving talks, or I ask great people I know of prayer, women and men, you know, to pray for me. I've got a hermit in Jerusalem who's terrific, and you know, so unfortunately it means I can't attribute to myself any glory, you know, because the Lord has made this clear to me, you know, but I'm privileged to be a go-between, and I think, yeah, it's grace and it's grace and it's grace, and our efforts are very, very important, but we won't really meet Christ Jesus or even feel the need for him until we know that we can't. You know, we can't do the all that we want to do, as St. Paul says, you know, you can't. And so it's the discovery that in the process I'm being loved, you know. And yes, it would be great if I was Mother Teresa by Tuesday, But, you know, in the meantime, the Lord and I have to bear with myself, you know. As Therese says, I must learn to bear with myself with all my faults and failings, you know. So wise. And there's a great humility in that. I had a spiritual director, or not a spiritual director, I had a great spiritual master who wasn't my novice master, but he was a great individual, Dominican, when I joined the order. And I was from the north of Ireland. I think I wanted to be holy by Tuesday, and he had to slow me down. And he was very holy, very ascetic, great man himself, you know. But he, I think he knew I was into Neo-Pelagianism or something. So he said to me one day, he said, "Brother Paul, always resist conversion," he said. "It's invariably short-lived, and it's so painful for everybody else while it lasts." So. Great. Thank you very much.